my favorite answer is really one thing that Marcus was asked by a film critic, I think, you know, how did he envisage the perfect society? And his answer, which seems to me lovely, was that he saw it in terms of a kind of an infinite cinema program where you could choose to live a different film each day. No. And that what they were, the reason that the Zapatistas had risen up was because they had been forced to live the same film for the last 500 years. So I think, I mean, if you really think of winning, that's what it would mean. I think we is really a question, and I think it has to be a question. So if I say we, you know, we hate capitalism, okay? That's a feeling I have that I'm not the only one. It's kind of a feeling and a gamble, and that in fact the world is full of people who hate capitalism or hate the consequences of capitalism or hate whatever they understand as the system, let's say. No. But I don't know. The we, for me, I think is a way of saying we are undefined. You know, we're not a definite group. Now, I can define us. I can say we are the proletariat, for example. And in some ways, I'm quite happy to say we are the proletariat, except that then I would say proletariat has to be understood as something that is undefined. Really, I would say, in fact, I suppose, that I see the proletariat as the movement of creative doing against alienated labour.
There is this extremely expansive we that social theorists, particularly of the Marxist direction, like to use to describe an already existing or a potential revolutionary or transformative subject, somebody who will change the world. It's always already a we. When I say we now, I mean, I'm talking much more concrete. As much as I'm a theorist, I'm also an activist. I'm talking about the we on the street here now. I'm talking about the we at the Alternative Summit. I'm talking about the we at the camps. I'm talking about at the various blockades in these processes that are concretely part of these processes. That's the we that I'm initially talking about. Now, of course, that we then expands because social movement activism doesn't just happen at blockades, in squats, or at events. It actually exists in a sort of field of ideas and discourses and practices. So when we go home from these and share the experiences that were had here and the kind of ideas that were produced and the encounters that they had with other people, with their family, with their friends, they're actually... they're multipliers. They multiply the experiences here and sort of feed them back into wider society.
This war is not for power people or for rice. This war is for everybody. If they want to see us every time, we cry, we suffer, they blow us. They make this war so hard every day. They want to see us, they want to see people fighting, they want to see people cry. They want to see people, their brother kill his brother, the sister kill his sister. We resist against this atrocious system, this bomb atomic philosophic. We fight them, but we don't fight with bomb, we don't fight with gun, we fight with music. We fight with demonstration. We fight with right. We fight for our rest. We don't get nothing. We are a poor people. But if we are together one, we can win. We can win. We will win. And this world will be like a paradise.
Multitude, as far as I understand it, is especially about trying to bring in all of the different social struggles that exist at this time, in post-Fordism. So, and it's trying to get away from this idea of there being one revolutionary subject or one revolutionary moment that needs to be engaged with in order to achieve change. For that, I'm really grateful, and I think the term multitude is important. Where I think it becomes problematic is trying to fill it with content. And as far as I understand Hart and Negri, they say the content is given by the particular struggles in the particular in the action that comes comes about, and also and many times that is also prefigured by the struggles that people are engaged with. So it's not this top down, okay, intentional. How are we going to change this world? That actually things change through processes, through structural processes that are happening. At the same time, as an activist, somebody who doesn't just sit behind the computer and read books, I wonder how we can use the term multitude in ways that make sense for us in terms of actually achieving our goals. And there, I think we need to have more conversations. Like, how do we think about our intentions? How do we build power? How do we build movements? What does that mean in the particular? And there, I find that suddenly the term multitude is limited. One of the questions that does get discussed a lot within movement circles is the question of power. What is power and can we take it? And often you see this dividing line between people who want to take power in this sort of classic sense of the word that often engage in parliamentary politics and really try to access traditional power structures. And you have people that reject that notion of power and understand it much more as a kind of relational understanding of power that is, the power manifests itself in very many different ways in people's everyday lives, and so you have to have many struggles that deal with these different situations where power exerts itself and where a power relationship exists. So in terms of understanding counterpower, I think it can be useful to talk about counterpower when we come together in these particular moments and in during a protest or something where what we're doing is not engaging in a zero-sum power game, like we take some power away from them and then we've got some, that more like we're generating power, we're empowering ourselves through this process. I think that's what we need to focus on, and then our power is limitless.
I tend to think in terms of anti-power rather than counter-power, or in terms of power too. That if you actually look at the way we use the word power, we use it in two different senses. No? We use it in the sense of power, our power to do something. No? Going on a big demonstration gives us a feeling of power. No? But this becomes converted in capitalism into something else. It becomes converted not only in capitalism as well, in other class societies, but it becomes converted into something else. It becomes converted into power over. No. Okay. So power is my ability to exercise power over you, to tell you what to do or influence what you're going to do. Yeah. Now, then the question is to see that this power over is nothing but the transformation of our power too. Okay, capital is nothing but the transformation of our capacity to create into a power that stands over and against us. Right. Okay. So, in other words, capital is something that we create and that depends upon us. If it depends upon us, then we're saying, well, that at the moment we live in a society in which this power over dominates our power to, our capacity to do things, our capacity to create. But finally, this power over depends upon our power to. Okay? So we live in a society in which the powerful actually depend upon the apparently powerless. Right? Okay, and that seems to me to be the source of hope, right? So the question is then, well, how do we develop our power to, our capacity to do things, in a way that goes against and beyond the power over?
I do think that it's a beyond, but perhaps, and John Holloway is one that I would agree with on this, it's probably like that there is no such thing as a total capital, like there isn't. And that doesn't mean we like break through capital and get to the other side. And I actually really don't like that kind of imagery. I do like the imagery of sort of rivers and cracks and streams and capillaries, because there's so many spaces in every day that we can see that the capitalist logic isn't able to claim that entire space. And so the beyond that I see is it's not really so utopian, actually, because it's actually recognizing A, our basic desires and our joys and what we like, and also the power that we have when we get together. So it's stuff that we're already doing in many ways. When we recognize that that's a potential crack, we can like really burst it open and also make it connect to others, right? So I think a lot of what the work that we have to do is recognizing that the beyond or the despite, you know, is already here with us.
Wir hatten die Fünf-Finger-Taktik. Das war eine Taktik, in der wir als große Gruppe losgegangen sind und uns aber immer gespalten haben, gerade dann, wenn irgendwo eine Polizeikette auf uns zugegangen ist, dass wir dann halt aus einem Strom zwei Ströme geworden sind, sodass die Polizeiketten sich halt immer weiter auseinanderziehen mussten und am Ende so große Lücken waren, dass wir eigentlich ganz gemütlich durchlaufen konnten. Und das war eigentlich das Ganze dahinter. Also wenn genug Leute da sind, ist eigentlich alles machbar.
It is fundamental that our struggle should be asymmetrical to capital. In other words, if you think of capital not as a thing, but as a form of social relations, as a way of organizing the world, or a way of doing things, then anti-capitalism means proposing and creating a different way of doing things, a different way of organizing, a different way of relating to one another. Okay. Once we become, so that the real enemy is not so much them as us becoming like them. You know, once we become like them, we've lost. If you think of a revolutionary struggle, you know, that I mean, it's so often it's happened that the leaders of the revolution just finish up being like the other side. You know, they win power. After a while, they're really no different from other political leaders. You know, the traditional capitalist form, of course, is for organizing society is through the state. The state involves certain hierarchies, involves a process of excluding people. Now, states, in the best of cases, what the state does is say, you go home, we'll take care of your problems for you, we'll act on your behalf. You know? And within the anti-capitalist movement, really from the beginning, there has always been an alternative sort of organization, usually called a commune or a council or an assembly or a Soviet or what have you, where the idea is no. Everybody should be involved. Everybody should participate. We will take things together. We will make decisions together. We won't have hierarchies. You know, if we do have leaderships, they should be rotating leaderships. It's a completely different principle of organization.
Angela!
Angela! Angela! Angela!
Angela! Ach, Anke, das bist du!
Angela!
Anke! Ja!
Anke. Na, der Schopfleisch!
Ah, das ist doch die Anke! Na, der Anke! Ja, ich heiße ja Eleonore! Da haben wir was gemeinsam! So. Ach, und hier schrauben sie ihren Stock fest! Ist der denn auch fest? Ja!
Ja, der Chef!
Ja, und hier ist eine kleine Sicherheitslücke aufgetreten.
Eine Sicherheitslücke?
Oh, oh, die müssen wir gleich verkleben, reparieren.
Ja, können Sie die verkleben? Kann man denn so Sicherheitslücken einfach verkleben?
Ist doch auch gefährlich so.
Ja, da kann ja ein Terrorist durchgucken.
Und hier noch viel größer.
Ach, auch noch ich eine Sicherheitslücke? Of course, in liberal capitalist democracies, there are certain freedoms and abilities that we have. Say, this protest wouldn't be possible absolutely everywhere. Those freedoms weren't given to us by states, they were fought for by social movements, and they were gained, they were achieved against the state. They were never given by the state. But having fought for these freedoms, we've now created a space where, of course, the state has to make, you know, certain allowances. That is to say, given that there's a nice, happy, peaceful samba band and some clowns are standing at the front of this blockade, you know, and lots of media people now, what would it precisely mean if the police just came in, fired rubber bullets, shot pepper spray, and water cannoned the fuck out of everybody? That would be politically rather costly. So there's also, there's not just a kind of current network versus hierarchy way of overcoming the power of the state, there's also the kind of historical residue of struggles that give us space where we can fight in that the state that from which we pushed the state back. The point of the blockades of the Block G8 campaign that I'm a part of here is to delegitimate the G8. And that has to be seen in the context of the Glen Eagles protests, or not protests, more than marches, 2 years ago, where what in other countries or other contexts could have been a march or a protest critical of neoliberal globalization of global capitalism actually turned through the Make Poverty History campaign into a bunch of cheerleaders for the Blair and Brown government, and which, to put it quite straight, to ask the G8 to make poverty history was really asking it to accumulate and amass more power to run the world. Because really, I mean, if you wanted to make more poverty history, you'd need an awful lot of power. The same thing was Angela Merkel, the German Chancellor, was trying to do the same thing right now with climate change, to kind of siphon off opposition and transform it into support for her government program and her position around the climate change question, the same way that Tony Blair did around Africa and debt. So for me, it was really important to be part of a campaign that says no. You know, not only do we not want to give more power to the G8, we also don't, like some NGOs do, you know, ask the G8 to be nicer and better and say, look, you're doing this wrong, you're doing that wrong. We're saying the whole bloody institution is illegitimate, as, of course, is the system the capitalist system and the state system that produces it. On the other hand, I think what's very important, what happens at a protest like this, is not just that we show to the outside that G8 is illegitimate or capitalism sucks or that we blocked the summit. What happens, say, at a blockade like this, where yesterday morning we arrived with, it's a bit unclear, but somewhere between 3,000 and 5,000 people when we came to this road, over 1,000 people spent the night. And now there's probably, I'd say by now, about 2,000 again. There's dancing, there's meetings, there's food, there's all manners of stuff. I'm sure there's love on the barricades. The processes that happen at these kinds of events, at these mass blockades over 24, 36 hours between individuals, between groups, between movements, are what I actually take to be a real globalization from below.
Until the G8's dead!
If I talk in Spanish, for example, and I want to say we, I prefer, where you have to choose between saying nosotros, which is a masculine we, or nosotras, which is a feminine we, then I would prefer to say nosotras. I mean, I think that the we that is emerging and that has emerged over the last 10, 15 years, the we of struggle against capital, actually that there is a kind of a change in the gender composition, if you like, of this we, that there is a sense in which we can talk of the old proletariat, the kind of factory-based proletariat, is very much a masculine, men-dominated movement. That the upsurge of struggle now, in some ways, is still, I'm not saying it's now not men-dominated, in lots of ways it is, but there is, I think, a very important shift in the gender composition of the movement, not only in the sense of its actual composition, but also in the sense of challenging, I suppose, gender stereotypes.
The multitude obviously entails many different subjectivities. It's the first thing to say about that. Therefore, the female subjectivity would be one of those. I think it's problematic to talk about the movement as feminized in that way, because I don't really know what that means. I know a lot of the discussion around the feminization of labor, for example, now, especially with immaterial labor, the discussions that go on in circles where people are reading Empire and Multitude and Hart and Negri's work and Lazzarato and sort of engaging with the idea of this new subjectivity that comes about with sort of post-Fordism and late capitalism, as people like to say. And there, the idea that now affective labor, care labor, these sorts of things are becoming central, they are the new commodity, has something to do with this idea of feminization. Another way that perhaps you could understand it is perhaps that the ideas or the way that we want to behave towards each other is one that rejects the sort of classic masculine ways of understanding power, of understanding the world. The definition between me and the other person is one that is with competition or fear or threat, these sort of very masculinist ways of understanding things. At the same time, I think the problem with putting it in those terms is that we essentialize femininity. We really do reify some sort of feminine subjectivity which doesn't exist, and I don't think should exist if we're talking about emancipation and liberation from what is often said as these dichotomies between male and female. What is male? What is female? I think it's not helpful for us to think in those terms. I think we have to think beyond and towards becoming rather than looking towards identifying these identities.
Wir sind die Nacht im Bach! Geh auf! Geh auf! Wir sind die Nacht!
the anti-capitalist movement moves through breaks all the time. It moves through ruptures, it moves through leaps. So that if we kind of try and project from the present situation, and the danger is that we're actually imposing some sort of closure on the future. I mean, if you think back and say, if you'd ask somebody that, say, just before the Zapatista uprising, then clearly any projection would have been completely wrong. The same just before Seattle, the same before lots and lots of events. You know, that it's very important to take, to think of the movement in terms of jumps and surprises, but jumps and surprises that don't just surprise them, the enemy, as it were, but actually surprise us as well.
I think over the last few days there has been a real sense that we are winning. What does that mean? It means that we were able to be out there blockading and disrupting the process of the eight most powerful countries in the world. They're meeting their show of power, because obviously we all know that they don't make decisions when they come together in these moments. It's a display of power. That's why it's so important for them to be able to meet in this way. So I think we were able to disrupt that massively. We were able to blockade. We were out there confronting this moment, sending quite a clear message that, you know, they're not welcome here. It's an illegitimate meeting. At the same time, the other side of that winning moment is that we have a sense that loads of people came and loads of people wanted to be part of that. Resistance is also something that is joyful. It's not always this negative kind of resistance. It's something that is full of fear and anger and it's something that also people can come together and celebrate that moment. So in that sense, we are winning. Overall, what does it mean to win? I think that is very much part of it. This coming together of people, this exchange, and the discussions that happen here, the moment that people experience together out on the streets or in the fields in this context, people take that back into their everyday lives, and it's the everyday struggles that are also so important. And you can't have one without the other. You can't have a G8 summit protest and then everybody go back home and mobilize just for the next one. It has to, the struggle is located in people's everyday lives. And it's that people take back, I think, from these moments. People come back from things like this changed, and that feeds into what they're doing. And they will have created new networks as well, and maybe, worked on new projects or started to develop things here. So that, what does it mean to win? That for me is what it means to win.
The G8's legitimation strategy in Heiligendamm was very much about climate change. Any strategy that tries to legitimate global authority in the near future will have to also deal with climate change. But funny enough, at least in Germany, the radical left seems to not at all realize that. We did set our issue focuses on militarism, migration, and global agriculture. There were these days of action. And then on the blockades. We need to work on developing a critical story about climate change that is anti-capitalist, that asks the question of property and class struggle, that doesn't just chime in with these individual appeals to changing your behavior and flying less, but actually talks about collective social transformation. Another way in which there wasn't a clear antagonism was a tactical one on the streets. Basically, the Block G8 campaign has said, we want to blockade the roads going to Heiligendamm. We do not intend to storm the fence, which, fair enough, the fence was probably, from a tactical point, insuperable, as in we couldn't have gotten over it. When we arrived there, I'm sure the police would have tried to stop us had they had a chance at the moment we got there. Once we were sitting on the road, it was pretty obvious, let's say, by the time the next day, Thursday, came around, that it would be far too politically costly for the police to evict us from there. The state had simply said, okay, look, you guys go there, you do your blockade here, we use boats and helicopters, which admittedly was annoying. I mean, some journalists got stuck for hours and hours on boats, and clearly we disrupted the logistics of the summit. But the point is that we sat in a space that the state had abandoned. Once we had gone there, the state said, look, you stay there, we don't hit you off the street, because if we knock you off the street, that'll look very bad for us. We will leave you to sit there. That was a situation which created precisely this feeling that there wasn't an antagonism, because if they can go ahead with their summit, and we can successfully have our blockades, then I guess our blockades are really successful in a grander political scheme of things. I think it's important for a libertarian anti-capitalist movement to say, look, if the state vacates a certain space, we need to keep pushing it. We can't sit down and say, ah, great, the state leaves us this street, we can sit down and have this blockade. Because then we have to ask, why does the state leave us this road? Well, obviously because it's not central to their plans, right? If the summit can go ahead without really being disturbed by our blockades, then we have to move on the blockades. Because then our blockades became kind of one funky space that the media could film and talk about, and then the summit went ahead as planned, right? Maybe if there had been a bigger ruckus right by the fence, you know, we could have shifted reporting about the summit away from the successes that Merkel was scoring on the inside and towards the outside, towards the fight, towards the confrontation, towards the antagonism. If we won with our blockades, but Merkel still won with her summit, then the point is that there is no antagonism between us and them. And that, I think, was the failure of Heiligendamm. I don't mean to say that Heiligendamm was a failure full stop. It had its successes, but it also had its failures.
The reason I think another world is possible is because the more you look around, the more you realize that another world has already been created. I mean, the one thing that just with the last couple of days of meetings, I mean, talking to people who are involved in all sorts of projects in all sorts of places, it's just so fantastically impressive what they're doing. And so amazing, and they're so clear that it's a process of struggle and the process of experimentation and the process of finding their way and the process of creating. I mean, I think that's really what makes me confident that, yes, another world is possible because it really is being created. I mean, if you think of that, I mean, a minute ago I was talking about this kind of force that is pushing through. I mean, to put that in Marxist classical theory, the idea of revolution is that the productive forces pushing against the capitalist relations of production. And if we think of productive forces not as being technology, which is the kind of the Communist Party vision anyway, but if you think of it as being people's creativity and a push towards self-determination, then you can see that the present situation as being one in which, yes, there really is a tremendous push of these productive forces against the relations of production. And of course there are all sorts of problems. I mean, there are all the problems associated with, I suppose, the birth pains of a new society. You know, and there's no certainty that the new society will be born, but the potential is just so obviously there at the moment.
Ich fordere Sie auf, hier über das Feld in Ressler.
if you think of, you know, what the 21st century revolutions looked like, I don't think they looked like 1917. We have to think not so much in terms of great events. I mean, there may well be great events, but the real revolution is this constant pushing and pushing of revolt and creativity that is already taking place.
Hi!